Poultry privately. Whatever you come to shout over here doesn't matter. You're overcome by fornication privately. Whatever you are shouting in the public doesn't matter. And you are overcome by drunkenness, or you are overcome by temptation. Whatever you come to say in the public matters not at all. You're a slave of sin, a slave of evil, and a slave of the flesh. Look at verse 20. For Eve, after they have escaped the pollution of the world, and through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome. The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. Instead of growing, instead of coming to the positive side, they're going to the negative. Instead of going up, they're going down. Instead of increasing, they're losing the grace of God in their lives. And the latter end is worse than the beginning, for it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it is happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the soul, the pig, the swine that was washed to a wallowing in the mire. And that's why the Lord is warning us, come back to the foundation and come back to the revelation of the word of God as taught by Jesus Christ himself. Revelation chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21. We're reading from verse 8. For the fearful, you're so fearful you cannot emphasize the word of God. You're looking at the faces of men and the faces of women. Because of that, you won't talk about repentance. Because of that, you won't talk about restitution. Because of that, the fear of man, you'll not talk about holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. The fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, and all, he tells us, are murderers and all mongers. Those are adulterers, fornicators, the fleshly people, those who lust, and sorcerers, witchcraft, familiar spirits, and idolaters, and all liars, private liars, pulpit liars, those who come to tell lies on the pulpit, those who take the word of God, they turn it upside down. They misinterpret, they misapply. They're liars, pulpit liars, private liars, public liars. It says, all liars shall have their part in the lake with burneth with fire and with brimstone, which is the second death. What's the Lord calling us to? If he has shown us a foundation, what's the Lord calling us to? He's calling us to faithfulness. If you're a disciple, you need to have loyalty, faithfulness, commitment, single-mindedness towards the Lord. And this faithfulness is to be seen first in the ministers, in this faithfulness of disciples with ministerial loyalty. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. We're reading from verse 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. We're reading from verse 2. Moreover, it is required, is stewards, that a man be found faithful. It's required in pastors that a man be found faithful. It's required in church leaders that a man be found faithful. You see, maybe you are faithful when it comes to every area of the word of God, as long as it doesn't touch your family. For example, we know that the Lord cannot use sinners to reach out to other sinners and to bring other sinners into the kingdom of God. Maybe you happen to be a pastor and your wife happens to be the women leader over there. But you cannot be faithful in that area because you know that your wife, if your wife were another woman, you will say, my sister, please go and sit down. You need to pray because you know, your wife fights. Your wife gets angry. Your wife tells lies. Your wife does all these things, and because she's your wife, you're not faithful. You leave her there. She's leading people that are more righteous than herself. She's leading people that are more obedient than herself. Maybe it's your son. Your son is playing the keyboard, and your son is doing this and that. And you know your son is stealing. You know your son is smoking. You know your son is not living according to the word of God. And you say, my son, this thing you are doing is not good. You know now, if I stop you, because I should stop you, the public will be asking, what happened, what happened? I don't want to expose you. So, my son, be careful. This is not good. Don't allow me to deal with this sin, with the Bible. You're not faithful. You're partial. If it's other children, you say, come on here. Don't you know the word of God? The people that serve me will lead righteous lives. And if you're not born again, a sinner cannot lead another sinner. If a blind man leads another blind man, they'll fall into the ditch. Hey, you know how to quote scriptures when it applies to other people, other children. And when it's your child, you cannot apply the Bible. You're not faithful. It is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. And maybe it's the choir in your location, the choir in your locality, in your region, or in your state. You know that all those things they're doing, they're just there just to waste time. They're not ministering to the people. Their heart is not in what they're doing. Their mind is not in what they're doing. They're looking for the praise of men. And once you clap, they're happy. And if they don't do well, you must still clap. If they do rubbish, you must still clap. And that's what they're looking for. And you cannot take a stand. And if anybody takes a stand, you are the one that will be going behind and making trouble because you are not faithful. We're no more looking at the Lord and looking at what the Lord wants and what he requires. And you are helping those people to remain on the way to hell, on the way to perdition. If you're going to come back in the way that leads to life eternal, you are preparing for the coming of the Lord, you will be faithful. If it's not just tradition and not just religion. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. I pray you'll be faithful in Jesus' name. Am I talking to somebody there? You'll be faithful in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. We're looking at verse 2. And the things which thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to what kind of men? I said, what kind of men? Faithful men. Who shall be able to teach others also? There's no tribalism here. And there's no sexualism here. And there's no favoritism here. You commit to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Now we cannot choose for you. You are free to marry a believer. But let's say, for example, you are a pastor. Let's say, for example, you are an overseer. Let's say, for example, you are a high leader in the church of the living God. And you want to marry. You're free. Marry anybody you want to marry. But if you marry a new convert, if you marry somebody who doesn't know the doctrines of the Bible, if you marry somebody who cannot stay firmly that this is the way, walk ye therein. If you marry somebody who is a novice, and she herself is still trying to understand. My husband tell me, this institution, what is it in the Bible? You're still trying to help her. My husband tell me, what is it that says, if you're angry with your brother, with your sister, and you call her Reka, thou fool, you'll be in the danger of hell. My husband tell me, what is it that it says, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. She doesn't know. And then because she's your wife, automatically she becomes a woman leader. The Bible doesn't say that. The Bible doesn't say that if you marry a novice, if you marry somebody who is a new convert, You're free to marry once you marry a believer. But if that person does not know the way of the Lord and the way of righteousness, you cannot put her over all those women in your district, over those women in your group, over those women in the region, or the women in the stage. That's what he's saying over here. The things you have heard and the things you have learned, you commit them to faithful men and faithful women who shall be able, having ability to teach, having understanding to teach, having the authority of life to teach. That's what the word of God says. And if you're going to be faithful, that's the thing to do. It's not just that, you know, he's a leader, I'm a leader, everybody's a leader, and then we come to the pulpit and we cannot teach the people the word of God. Get those faithful people, the people that accept the word, and the people that live by the word, that will teach other people with conviction. And they back it up with the kind of life they live. We're looking at Psalm 119. Psalm 119. And we're looking at verses 33 and 34. You're not choosing somebody from your tribe. We're from the same locality. We speak the same local language. We're from the same local government. When did you come? When did you come to the church? I came last year. And what do you know? I'm born again. You're born again. I don't have any of my people, any of my countrymen as a pastor, as an overseer. All right, get ready. They will call you for question and answer. For region overseer, they'll ask you this question, this question, this question. Begin to write that now. If they ask this question, give this answer. If they ask this question, give this answer. You're a politician. You're not a Christian. You're not faithful. You're not there to serve the Lord. You're there to serve your tribe. You're there to be tribalistic. And God will remove you out of that place. Everybody give me a good amen there. Psalm 119, I'm reading verse 33. Teach me, O Lord, the way of thy statutes, and I shall keep it unto the end. Here is consecration. Here is commitment by somebody that said, I know that is the right way. I know that that is what to do. Teach me, O Lord, your way, and I will keep that way to the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law. Yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart. We don't serve the Lord with, half-heartedness service. But we serve the Lord with all our heart. And we make a commitment to the Lord. Look at 1 Kings chapter 22. 1 Kings chapter 22. Here we're reading from verse 13. 1 Kings chapter 22. And we're reading from verse 13. It says in verse 13, and the messenger that was gone to call Micah spake unto him, saying, behold, now the words of the prophets declare good unto the king with one mouth. False prophets are prophesying lies unto the king. And he said it with unity. And let thy word, I pray thee, be like the word of them, and speak that which is good. Here is a false prophet trying to influence Micah. And Micah said, as the Lord liveth, what the Lord says unto me, that will I speak. If you're a faithful person, somebody, a backslider, comes to tell you to walk in the way of backsliding and to say the wrong thing, and to do the wrong thing, you should be able to say, no, I'm committed to the Lord. I've surrendered my soul, my heart, my life, my future, my destiny unto the Lord. I cannot do that. And when you commit yourself totally to the Lord like that, then you know that you are going to do, you're going to say only what he has said. It tells us it's only when we hold on and we hold to that truth until the very end. That's how we can be saved. And that's how we're going to see the Lord on that final day. Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3. And I'm reading from verse 6. Hebrews chapter 3. Reading from verse 6. Here is what the Lord is telling us. Because he expects us to be faithful until the very end. Hebrews chapter 3, we're reading from verse 6. For Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope from a firm unto the end. All you have learned, if you are faithful to it until the very end, and you hold it firm, and you will not let it slip, it will not slip away from your hand, then you'll be a partaker of that kingdom of God. Verse 12, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. You were in the Lord before, you've been in the Lord, and you've been serving the Lord, you are saved. You've done your restitution, you were sanctified, you are filled with the Holy Ghost, and you have been faithful to the Lord. Hold that fast to the end. Verse 13, but exhort one another daily, whilst it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin, through the deceitfulness of evil, the deceitfulness of the things of the world. It says in verse 14, for ye are made partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast to the very end. That's what the Lord is calling us to. He's saying, hold it fast. Hold it fast until the very end. All the doctrines we have learned, all the manner of life he has revealed unto us, hold it to the very end, so that you will not lose your soul, you will not lose your reward, you'll not lose your crown. Revelation chapter 22. Revelation chapter 22 from verse 12. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they which do his commandments, not those who rebel, not those who disobey, not those who backslide, not those who look down at the word of God, not those who change the convictions of the word of God, not those who lead other people astray. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gate into the city. Verse 15, for without, outside are the dogs, and the sorcerers, and the whoremongers, and the murderers, and the idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. Verse 18, for I testify unto every man that heareth these words, the words of these, of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written therein in the book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, and out of the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. After saying that, he now reminds us, it's coming again, and you need to be ready for his coming. It's coming again. You need to hold fast the word of God that you have learned about.
You are listening to our pastor, Pastor W.F. Kumuyi, or other anointed minister of God from our ministry. Let the word sink in your heart, and they will do you good throughout your whole life. It is our belief by the grace of the Lord that you will come and worship with us at Deeper Life Bible Church, number 4656 Briarwood Drive. We have our service every Sunday from 9 a.m. to 11:30. And we have our Bible study on every Monday from 7 to 8:30. As you are doing so, the grace of the Lord will continue to be with you and you will never be the same. Thank you. God bless you.